The talk today is about digitalization, whether it's a curse or a blessing. The talk is in English, yes, I was asked to do so, so it's a pleasure to do that. Also, I would like to try the Sway tool from Microsoft, because the poor old PowerPoint with all the animations, I'm really fed up with that. This one has some new cool animations, and therefore I would like to switch here to this new style. The first thing we recognize already, you really have to find the button to press, and you must not miss it. So therefore, we keep it this way, hopefully. So the talk is a little bit about, it's interactive again. So as you can remember from last time, it was a question and answer session. This one is not that much question and answer. It's just to ask you thinking a little bit what we can do with the data, what kind of data we are providing to others, and how you can misuse this data. So therefore, let's start. It's about digitalization. And when you look in the past, this is due to the network here at the university, we recognize already, you see the digitalization and the industrialization. The digitalization is a new industrialization from many, many years ago, you can say. There was a real cut in the privacy of people, in the industrialization, how people work, how they spend time, how they work together. And you see these big environments where all the ladies were sitting. This one was the past, and the contra for industrialization and the fear of the people was, of course, they are cutting our jobs. We have much more to work. We have to work faster. And all these negative aspects came immediately into their mind. You have work in a row according to small parts of tasks you just have to perform. You don't see the big picture anymore. This seen as an impersonal job for the people. And the cultural and the knowledge inflation also happens at that time. This is the contra, and I always try to show you also the pros of these kind of things. And when you look at the industrialization, how it looks today in a car manufacturing area, you see new jobs and new areas of responsibilities arise. So you don't need to concentrate on these coils anymore, but you have new jobs, new responsibilities. You're responsible for robots, for manufacturing parts, for groups of people, and so on. You have an easier workload. So actually, you can be more flexible with your time, how you're spending your time, what you're doing with your time. You're increasing your efficiency, of course. That's all what it's about. It's money. And the personal network you can extend by using these kind of industrialization and digitalization, which my talk is about. And the culture and knowledge is, in this case, for all. Looking into these aspects a little bit deeper, we could ask ourselves whether we can afford to forego this progress. I would say no, you have to cope with it somehow. In some aspects, you don't want to live in the same way as 100 years ago. Yeah? You don't want to use the tools as 100 years ago. You're happy with your mobile phones. You're happy with your telephones. Who wants to live today in the same environment as 100 years ago? Who has too much time? Yeah, this is the question, because efficiency is coming up. You need to be faster. You need to accelerate your business, your jobs, and everything. And who wants to stop learning? Yeah, you're here because you want to learn new things. You want to have your master, your bachelor at the end of the years. And you don't want to have stagnation. So the following examples I would like to give you is about digitalization, not industrialization, digitalization, the next step. And we are just in the middle already, because everybody has a smartphone nowadays. And I would like to turn back the time a little bit around 100 years ago. So I will do it this way. This is more reliable. So think about this thing. What is that? So, and this is the interactive part, because I would like to know whether you still recognize this or whether your grandparents had such a thing. Any idea what you can do with that? It doesn't look this way today's anymore. Yeah?
It's a stove.
A what?
Where you can cook,
yes, with fire. So with real log fire underneath, and then you can cook on that. Yes, but this was really a bone job. You had to collect the wood, you had to get the fire running. It was an increased fire risk, of course, because easily when you open the stuff, the fire could come out, and it's really difficult to control it. It was not possible on a scale from 1 to 10 to adjust the heat and to reprogram everything, maybe for the future that the oven starts in 1.5 hours to cook something. So this was extremely difficult, but our grandparents dealt with that. So looking at digitalization, this is how the thing looks today. And you have, of course, many, many options to program and to use time selection. We have no permanent supervision anymore. This is necessary. And you have really more time to do more meaningful things. The question to you is now, and this is interactive, what kind of data is leaking here? So what kind of data I'm providing to someone who is at the end of this machine, maybe in the cloud, maybe connected to the cloud? And what kind of data do these guys get? And what information can you derive from this? What are you eating? Whether you're eating healthy food and so on? Who might be interested in such information? Insurance companies, yes, correct. And that's the real risky thing, I would say, that you may have a diet, you may have allergies. Health information is really personal to you. You won't share this with everyone. But by using such a nice feature of such a machine, you're sharing this information with others, probably without knowing, because you just see the big advantage of downloading recipes to your machine. But at the other end, you can make use of this information. I'm not saying that it's done, but there is a big risk to do so. So guys, what is this one? Any idea? 100 years ago. Water heater, yeah. More generic, it's a central heating machine somehow. The central heating was extremely hard to control 100 years ago. We are past the area and the time frame of a log fire, yeah, you see. So you have central heating, but often it was too warm or too cold. It was a dirty business because you had to use coal and wood to get the fire running. And of course, you had soot and dust, and this endangers your health. When going back from this one to modern central heating environments, like this one, for example, then you have a central control, maybe with your smartphone. You have an environmentally friendly condensing boiler technology to really safeguard the environment. So that's really the positive aspect. And you have, of course, again, more meaningful things to time to do other things. So, but looking at this picture, you see already, okay, there is a temperature range and there is a connection. Okay, this thing is in the cloud and you can steer this from the outside. So if you're on vacation and you decide to come back a day earlier, you can switch on your central heating at home already. So, but what does this mean again? What is the risk here? What kind of data you're providing to someone? For burglars, it's very interesting if they would have access, right? Yes, to see whether you're in or out. That's very essential. Presence at home and what you are doing at home. And later on, I'm having a similar topic, and there you see at which granularity you already can derive from this information which goes into the cloud, what you're doing at home. Perfect. So next step. What is this one? A calculator, yes, it's a really, really old calculator. A slide rule. And my father was able to calculate with that. And I really stare at this item and cannot imagine how you can calculate. But yes, somehow with logarithmic scales and multiplication is just an addition of two distances. And it's quite interesting what mathematics did in the good old times, let's say, and where it all started with. And yeah, you had to do your calculation with your fingers and your brain. Yeah, today this is not necessary often anymore. You have a high error rate if you're not adjusting things or you're not reading the correct scale. And the capacity bottleneck is really your brain to do calculations fast enough. So looking for today, not really today, also some years ago, you have this kind of thing. Most of the time, the calculations are correct. You have definitely faster calculations, and you can significantly extend your calculation range, and you're much, much faster. If you're faster, you have more time to do more meaningful things. So what is the risk of this thing? No, just kidding here at this point in time. I just wanted to trick you a little bit. It's really a nice example, but not a real threat. Not from this type of calculator, of course. We are not talking about the app on your mobile phone. But then you're, of course, right. Next thing. Any idea what this is? Telephone, yes. And no buttons to press, yeah, no dial lists, no address book, no nothing. You really had to store all the numbers in your brain, and you had to type them in or dial them into this machine. Or you had to ask the lady, the nice lady, to connect you through to your other party. The bad thing is the caller identification was not possible at that time, or not so easily possible, so fun calls were possible. Dialing just some numbers and that you called someone and pretended to be someone else and that you tricked the people into something. And they did not see who was calling and so on. So this was really a fun part of it. On the other hand, you had really poor line quality and disconnections often, and you had a very high cost of human resources because of these connections. Looking today, yes, this is more stable. It's HD quality. It's really nice. You have the added value of caller identification now, so everybody can see who is calling, although you can suppress this, correct. But on the other hand, there are means in this digital network, of course, to grab you even afterwards, because everything is stored, everything is in the cloud, everything is at the big telephone companies. The flat rates, in the past, there was no flat rate. You had to pay per minute or per second. This was really a disaster to call to America. This was really expensive. Today, you have flat rates, and your calls can be extended length, and you don't have to pay very much for that. So what do you see as a risk of this kind of equipment when we're using that? So contacts, communication partners, mood and so on, so your mental constitution, all the information which is stored here in the cloud, it's really risky that we are losing this kind of information. So next one, that's a quite funny thing. How did our parents try to meet in the past? They had a date. They had a time and they had a location. And they said, in front of the Karstadt in the city center, the left entrance at 6 o'clock, I'm there. And then you were there. That's the way how it worked in the past. How does it work today? That's a German example. Hey kids, shall we meet each other again? Yes. When? Not tomorrow. Okay, not yet there, huh? Maybe day after tomorrow. No, there is football. Maybe Sunday. Oh, no, there my grandmother comes. Maybe Monday, and they are not yet there. Yeah, so it's really crazy. You are not arranging meeting points anymore, which is, of course, more flexible. Yeah, you have full control. You can adjust because of your mood. So if you try to visit to the cinema, for example, and you want to go there, and suddenly the weather is quite shiny and bright and sunny, and you decide, no, let's not go to the cinema, but to the beach. You can immediately do that, and you can inform all your party, maybe you join us at the beach instead of the cinema. Yeah, that's possible. And of course, you have the full flexibility and all the control, and you can do more meaningful things, whatever this means. So what is the risk here if you share this kind of information, of course, in the cloud, as we are doing here? Yes, relationships and contacts. So your personal network, with whom you're talking, with whom you're discussing, what are your favorites, what are you doing, what you're doing in your private life, and so on. All this information is revealed by this kind of information. This is about taxpayer formulas. This was the past, so we are still there, actually. So this is not yet 100 years ago. This is maybe today, for some people. Some people do it in an electronic form already. In the past, you had to fill out these bunch of papers, you had to fill out numbers, you have to calculate everything manually, you have to fill it in, then you have to send the stuff to your taxpayer government office, and they type in all the numbers in their computers, and this was extremely error-prone, and you have to do the same procedure every year. You have to calculate again and again the same numbers, and you had to type in all the, or to write in all the same numbers every time. Today, we are doing it in this way, in a taxpayer application, in a program. You have an extremely fast data transfer from the previous year to today's year. You're just adjusting a few data, a few information, which has changed, and you're sending the whole stuff preferably signed, electronically signed, to the tax office, and they have it immediately in their computers. They don't need to type in anything from paperwork anymore. And yeah, they see immediately everything, and you have more time to do more meaningful things. So what kind of information you're providing to the cloud? All the information about your financial status, your wealth, yeah, as long as you announce it, yeah, and have no hidden money at the Cayman somewhere. But in this case, yes, it's all your financial status, your wealth is blank, it's transparent. And that's the idea, of course, because the tax office would like to get some taxes from you. What else do we have? Ah, this one is nice. Do you know what this is? This is so old. This is so old, you don't know this anymore, but you heard about it. I recognize. Yes, that's the beautiful 50 Deutsche Mark, so 25 euros roundabout from several 10 years ago. At that time, only cash counted. Yeah, so you had to pay everything by cash, credit cards. My first credit card is from 1990 something. So it really started there. Before that, it was just cash, cash, cash everywhere, even on vacation. You had to think about when you went over to Italy or so. You had to exchange into Italian lira. You had to have traveler checks with you. You had to find bank accounts. Even ATMs were not that much introduced. So it was, you were always short of cash because you had to try to get the money from somewhere in your vacation and everywhere, and the small change was missing because you sometimes had just the big paper from the ATMs, and then you needed some small money for a Coke or whatever, and it was quite difficult in the past, and not everybody accepted, even when credit cards were introduced, accepted credit cards for a small amount of money. So how we do it today? How do we do it today? Yeah, this one we know, eh? Everybody knows about this sign. And the other sign, yeah, the Bitcoin or PayPal, everybody's using that. I've got the impression that really many, many people switch over to PayPal because it's convenient. And even, and you see the newspaper, everything is full with Ether or Bitcoin or Ripple the last days. And you see that everywhere. And everybody wants to get a little bit of this one. Money is still always isn't still available in sufficient quantity, yeah, but that's your personal problem. But it's more or less available at any time because you carry it with your in your mobile phone, you pay with your mobile phone. It's very convenient, very easy to do so. So what is a big risk? What are we providing from us? What kind of data is leaking? Yes, information where you're spending money, your cash flows, your assets, wealth, contact persons with whom you're exchanging money, and so on. Yeah, that's absolutely correct. So we are coming to the end. Maps, yeah, you know what this is? Yes, it's a map. But it's paper, it's printed. So on this kind of paper thing, which we used in the past, we had no navigation systems. Our navigation system was a partner at the in the car next to us, telling us which route to take. Yeah, and by this, we also found our way to Italy or to Spain. It was possible. But the big, big problem was you had to exchange this paperwork, you had to print this paperwork again and again on a regular basis because roads were changing. You had not always the right map at hand. Then you were in South Germany and you just had a map of North Germany and so on. And this was really a tricky time and you really had to prepare your journeys well enough up front. Yes, today, how do we do that? Galileo, GPS systems, everything, navigation systems. We use this with standalone navigation systems. We use this with mobile phones, even more convenient. And of course, you have even open street maps, which ensure that all the data is current to the date. Really, you're having actual data, and if there is a new street somewhere, it will immediately show up more or less immediately in the open street map which you're using to navigate. The way counts, so enjoy your journey, but this journey leads us to which risk? So what kind of data are we sharing? This is the high risk because commuting patterns, again, you're sharing, visited locations, then you could determine what are you doing there. is this is this just a shop to buy something, or is this maybe known for special practices, what you can do there, or special drugs you could buy there, or whatever. You could get this information, and if you're at the wrong time, at the wrong place, it may also affect your personally. So what else do we have in digitalization? So that's now the digitalization stuff for the heating, central heating we had in the beginning. Probably you have this still in your cellar, the meters, not yet smart meters, but power meters. The dirty, and that old times, the dirty, it's getting cleaner. The energy, the electricity comes just from the socket. And this won't change. But the way how our household is steered by these smart meters, and where do we get the energy from, and how do we estimate what kind of energy is needed, how much energy is needed, and so on. This is part of the future talk. It was difficult, very difficult to control these kind of networks in the past, and it is today. You have to have experiences. So if you have a world champion soccer and you have the half time is over and you have a break for a quarter of an hour, then you know exactly that at that point in time everybody will go to the loo, will switch on the coffee machine, will switch on the microwave or whatever, and you need energy and water in this period of time. But maybe you read the book Blackout. It's a very nice book which talks about a blackout over Europe, where all the smart networks crashed down. And this is due to a virus which was infected at that time. But there are other scenarios which you could make use of to really cause a blackout. And this is not that far away, I would say, in nowadays network. So we really have to do something there. How does it look today? So it shall look this way. We have green, and the green energy, the green electricity still comes from the socket. You have automatic control of the power grid by your smart meter. And yeah, you want to have a better environment for your children. But what kind of data is then leaking out to the cloud? So we had this example already before. It goes in the direction that you have information about when you're at home and even what you are doing at home. These kind of machine can really determine whether you're switching on your microwave, your washing machine, your television, and so on, because these are very characteristic patterns in your energy consumption. And this information, of course, is much more valuable for people who make use of this cloud information, this cloud data. Yeah, presence at home, home equipment, TV consumption, and so on. So I think this is the last example. This is also quite old. Some of you know what this is. Flight ticket, yes, a paper-based flight ticket. It's really, it's really vintage, I would say. I haven't seen this for 15 years anymore. I think since 10 to 15 years, we are just flying electronically. It was paper-based, it could be lost, it was hard to read, and if you have 3 or 4 carbon copies, then it was harder to read, and you got the last thing at the end, and then you had to determine which flight to where and where do I need to show up. It was quite difficult. Nowadays, we do it in a different way. Traveler tickets like this one here, you have a barcode. It's an easy identification. Storage in the cloud cannot be lost. So this is really great. You just show up with a personal identification at the counter and you get your ticket. That's extremely well organized, meanwhile. This picture is from a guy who did not reveal his name in the internet. He took a picture because he was on the flight from Toronto to San Diego and he was very proud of it. What kind of information I could determine from this from this screenshot? You have so much information in this barcode, so be extremely careful when you're taking a picture of a valid flight ticket to somewhere and post it on Instagram, on Twitter, on somewhere, on Facebook. Don't be proud of your travel, yes, that's fair, but don't show this bloody barcode, yeah? Because you have everything in there, and even if you're just about to board, I could, if I have access to this barcode, I could determine your flight, your identifier, this 6-character identifier. And with that, with the name which is in there, I don't need any more to cancel your flight. Even that's possible. So really be extremely careful with that. Credit card information, address, visited locations, travel plans. Behind that in the internet, all your travel eternity is stored in the cloud. You see there everything. Yeah? Credit card information, address, visited locations, your whole plan. And I could adjust this as I like if I have access to this cloud. So all this data, and we saw that many data is leaking, all this data is forming a picture of you. And we had this the last year as well. It's all about big data, consolidation of data, and forming pictures of everyone. You have travel information, you have health information, contact information, wealth, relationships we had, finance info information, location-based commuting patterns, travel information. All this together is you. So, what does it mean? Yeah, we want to be higher, faster, bigger. We want to create a future for us, and we want to make use of these fancy tools, gadgets. And I think after this presentation and even before, you don't want to live 100 years ago with a coal fire and with a bloody telephone, which is hardly doing a connection to somewhere. So therefore, we have to ask whether this is all necessary and what we can do to shape this future in a good way. So actually, this is all necessary because life is flowing. You're in a constant, steady flow, and you have to adapt yourself. Think about you're such a small tree somewhere. This tree does not get enough light, so you have to be at the top. So that's the reason why you have, most of the time, all these tall trees trying to reach for the best energy, for the best light, to get the most energy out of it. So you personally have to grow. This means don't be afraid of industrialization, digitalization, or whatever. You have to see the chance in it. And you see that there will be new jobs created, there will be new possibilities, new advantages, and it does not help to just protect yourself, not following all this and not doing all this, but you have to adjust yourself and you have to deal with that. And if the tree stops growing, the others will pass him and take the light, and this is the basis of your own life. So therefore, be strong and grow for yourself. Yeah, but how? You see there, this is the picture of the past, and yeah, there were the jobs and so on, and industrialization, and they are stealing our jobs, and they are transforming everything, and they will lay off us. Yes, but we will create new jobs with different flavors. IT security, I never heard 20 years ago about this, otherwise I would probably have studied it. So I had to go for electronics, computer science, a little bit of this, a little bit of that, and cryptography, and then a little bit together, and this formed a similar study, like this one as you are doing today. But this one was created because there is a need in the culture. And the company, the universities, did already a part of the job to create such studies, which you're joining here. The companies have to do their things because, on the one hand, they see people are just a cost factor. On the other hand, they recognize that people are helping to do their business. If you only see your people, your employees, as a cost factor, and you would lay them all off, you're cost-cutting a lot. But nobody would do the job anymore. So in this, there are a lot of calculations and studies about this. What is the value of a human being? Is a doctor more worth than another guy working at the street somewhere and cleaning the streets? But they are all contributing to the whole big picture. And therefore, companies who do industrialization, of course, have cost-cutting effects on the one hand, but they are creating new jobs on the other hand. And the companies then need to develop their people further, their employees, that they can adjust to these new challenges. The universities, I mentioned already, and the politics, of course, must face up to their responsibilities in their areas. You have to be open for this new adventure, and then it maybe looks in the future like this one. That might be you. But what is the price for all this? Yeah, the price we learned, and you knew that already, is all your data. And we decided to be transparent. We decided ourselves to provide all this data because we wanted to jump on the train. We want to have a mobile phone. We want to use it for many, many purposes, financial transactions, navigation, commuting, communicating, and so on. We want to have it convenient, simple, and time-saving, to have time for more fancy stuff, for more important things to do. Yes, of course. But it's our decision. And I said in the past, you have to adjust yourself. And yes, somehow you have to take the decision. But please take it in a very conscious way. And I think that's the price you have to pay. You have to learn your whole life. And this does not stop here after the university. I learned myself till today. And you have to secure your privacy, for example, through encryption. This is what you're learning here and what you can do to prevent data is leaking out. Authorization of accesses by authentication, two-factor authentication, really make use of this one. By that, you limit the number of data which is leaking to other parties which are not authorized by you, let's say. The best thing is data avoidance, data economy, and data minimization. So the least amount of data you're providing to others, and this coming in conjunction with the data privacy law in Germany. And this is really the best aspect, what you can do. And of course, continuous education, so stay tuned. During Christmas and New Year, there was the Chaos Computer Club celebration again in Leipzig this year with, I don't know, 100 talks and speeches. Most of them are available in French, English, and German in the internet on YouTube. Go there, have a look, and they are really up-to-date, very interesting talks of people. And this is the kind of learning you have to do all your life. So you always have to ask yourself, must it really be that I'm using this app, that I'm providing this kind of data? Is it worth the advantage which I have to provide this amount of data to other parties which I probably don't know and which may misuse this information? Yeah. So therefore, please always ask yourself whether this is really worth the data and what you're getting back from that. Thank you very much.